stage program. Over 18 months ago, John Snow Incorporated was brought on by the Prince George's County Planning Department, working in collaboration with the County Executive's Office to develop a primary health care strategic plan for Prince George's County. With us today, from John Snow, are Ann King and Alex McKinney to discuss the primary health care strategic plan, the outcomes and recommendations. I bring to you Alex McKinney, followed by Ann King. Thank you so much.
Hello, everybody. Everyone here, good morning. How many people are ready to get rid of the parkas? Come on. It is too cold. something that has been just incredibly impressive to all of us at John Snow, and the second I want to recognize our team, is just the level of communication that we have seen here in the county. You have all just been amazing. And people are still coming in. People are standing, standing room only. And it's just, particularly on such a cold day, it is incredibly impressive. And again, I'm sorry, but I'm going to have to give you another plus, give yourself another round of applause. This is re-engaging Prince George's style. I mean, you guys are great. I am really honored, and my whole team has been really honored and proud to be here in the county over the past year. We've had wonderful support, and I am just so confident this is really going to transform the system of care for the county, with the Regional Medical Center, but all of the other associated services and programs, public health efforts, population health services that are so critical to improving health. It is not just about a hospital. It is about all of the systems and supportive programs that really keep people out of the hospital, and the walkable streets, and there's just been such great efforts happening, and I just want to just sort of make that point. It's an absolute pleasure to be here. My team from John Snow, Ann Keen, Sarah Giannetti, and there are a number of people back home who weren't here today. It's just been a pleasure to be here and a pleasure to work with all of you. I'm here to talk about our assessment and what went into our assessment and a brief review of some of our findings. As Vanessa and Ms. Hager Francis said, it really was the foundation of the University of Maryland's impact assessment. We sort of took those results, added to them, looked specifically at primary care and to the other services, and thought a little bit about where are the gaps and how can we build a strong system. But it was really the foundation of the University of Maryland study that helped us to do that. So I'll be talking about our assessment findings as well, and then Ann Keen will be talking about our recommendations. So before I get into some of our findings, this was an extremely collaborative effort, but it was also well led by the county, and there was really broad leadership between the Office of the County Executive, the County Council, and the Board of Health. Hello? Okay, here we go. Sorry, folks. So it was a collaborative effort involving all of you, but it was also very led, and was led in a collaborative way by the county, by the Office of the County Executive, the County Council, and the Board of Health, the Maryland National Capital Park and Planning Commission, as well as the County Health Department. And it really was a broad level leadership team. But it also involved all of you, and it was such an essential part of our work, was involving all of the various stakeholders, from hospitals, health plans, physicians, nurse practitioners, nurses, early qualified health centers. The list goes on and on and on. Those looking after children's special health care needs, and those who are developmentally and disabled, all of those that really support the entire county, and particularly those people who are most at need and really struggle. And this participation was really meaningful. It was critical to developing our assessment and really critical to developing a recommendation and a pathway forward. We did do a whole series of community meetings, and they've been mentioned numerous times today. We had a very large meeting about a year ago that really helped us set the stage for our community engagement and our assessment overall. We then had four county meetings that were distributed throughout the region. There were much more of a conversation. almost like a focus group, trying to figure out, okay, well, what do you think are the major health issues? What are the underlying root causes of those health issues? And what do we need to do to make sure that we improve health, expand access, and really address the quality of care? And so we had these community meetings, and we had almost 200 people involved throughout these meetings. And frankly, I recognize many of you here that were at those meetings. So thank you so much for your participation. We also did stakeholder interviews with key health care professionals and other sort of related service providers through meetings and individual interviews. And then finally, we met with the Maryland State Medical Society, MedJai, and we did both presentations and meetings with their leadership. So it really was a broad community engagement. So overall, our assessment was, again, to build on the University of Maryland's impact assessment and think about how can we develop a strong, vibrant, comprehensive, high-quality primary health care system for the county to make sure that you really are moving into really this a national standard here in the county. So we looked at access to patient-centered primary care. And when I say primary care, I really mean behavioral health, oral health, primary care medical services, aligned with public health and really a really comprehensive patient-centered system. We also need to focus on improving health outcomes and hearing from you all, well, what are the issues and how can we make sure that we're really addressing quality, improved health outcomes. And then finally, the healthcare system is identified as one of the major drivers of the economy here in the region, as it is almost everywhere in the country. And how can we make sure that we take advantage of that and align what we're doing to make sure that it's creating the jobs and really keeping things here in the county. And so another major focus of ours was to make sure that we had this third leg of the stool here to make sure that the economic development was really vibrant and growing. Before I get into some of the findings in our assessment, I also just want to tell you sort of the underpinnings of our assessment. John Snow, Inc. How many people know who John Snow is? Oh, my Lord. Well, that's fantastic. John Snow is the father of public health. Really one of the first person who ripped the handle off of the London Broad Street pump and really sort of ended the cholera epidemic. And really he, John Snow, was really the person who really first identified sort of this very broad level, model of healthcare that just wasn't just about institutions, it wasn't about just one particular organization, but really a very broad perspective on health that starts with the individual, and all the behaviors that individual does that either promote their health or perhaps harm their health, and also the organizations that help them to support their health, the community certainly, safe streets, walkable streets, all of the parks of services that keep people healthy, and of course all of the policies and what our government does to help us make sure that the structures are there. So it really has to be a broad level, very comprehensive effort. And that's really the perspective that we took when we did our assessment. So, I'm gonna focus now for the next 10-15 minutes on our findings. And I will talk for 30 seconds about what we did, just so you have a sense of it. And then Ann Keene is going to come up and talk about our recommendations. We did do a comprehensive assessment, again, building on the University of Maryland study. We looked at all sorts of data from that assessment and also other data on primary care shortages, other service-related shortages, patient origin studies and all sorts of things to try to make sure where people were going to care, where they weren't going to care, and understanding gaps. We also, as I said, did community meetings, and collect all sorts of qualitative information to try to gather a sense of sort of the root causes of some of the issues that we were looking at. When all is said and done, the following is some critical issues that we found. So as been said, one of the most startling things we found is that people really are leaving the county for care. For whatever reason, they're going south to St. Charles. They're going into the city, particularly if you're in the Beltway. They're going up to Baltimore and Arundel County. And about one in two folks are actually not daily care here in the county. That was just a pretty stark finding we found across our community interviews, as well as in some of the raw data we found from actual patient utilization data. We also found that there's really a shortage of primary care. And this is a shortage of primary care across the board. This is in rural areas, this is in more suburban areas, and it's certainly in some of our more low-income communities where there is particular shortages. But it was really a cross-cutting issue and something that we found very starkly, again, building on what the University of Maryland found. We also found that there was a lot of small, adequate-sized space for medical practice. Especially low income. So we were trying to find, okay, where can we house practices to fill the gaps? It was really, we couldn't really find the spaces in order to where we could put and address these shortages. We also find a larger percentage of low income uninsured residents than most areas of the region. And as Ms. Creeper mentioned, high rates of chronic disease, which were really affecting poor health status. And this is true across so many indicators around chronic disease, diabetes, mental health issues, asthma. It was really pretty much across the board. There are wonderful things to say about the county, and some things were some areas worse than others, but there was really, if you look at the ranking out of Maryland's 24 counties, health outcomes, overall health status and wellness, 17 out of 24, length of life, premature death, 18 out of 24. And so they're really, the issues are pretty stark. Now there's some great news about the county, but some of the health issues are pretty extreme. And this is what we're all about, is to try to develop a system of care that's gonna address these issues and improve the health status for everybody. So through our community engagement exercise, we asked people, what are the health issues for you? What do you think see as the major health issues and gaps in services? And you all told us that the issues really fall into five categories, from access, quality of care, the patient-centeredness, for access to providers and staff, and really the comprehensiveness of services. So what you said to us is that you wanted to have care that was convenient, timely, affordable, and that it was able to serve the entire population, including those who had barriers to care and struggled, those with severe disabilities or children with special health care needs. You also said that you wanted care to be quality, respectful, coordinated, and where you really were really measured well against the benchmarks. And that was the most critical to you, and you were concerned that may not exist to the extent it needed to in the county. You wanted care that was patient-centered, where you felt like your providers were listening to you, helping you build your own health literacy and your understanding of your own health issues, that it was cultural competence, really responding to your unique situations and your unique culture. And you said, this is key, and this is what we need to have a really strong primary care system. You also spoke to the need for it to be, for you to feel like people were listening to you and being courteous, and creating a welcoming environment where you weren't having to wait a long time where you didn't necessarily feel disrespected when you came into the health system and said this was important to me and that we needed to focus on building these types of systems and these types of relationships. And then you said you wanted something that was comprehensive, part of an integrated system that included medical, behavioral health, oral health, as well as all of the medical specialty services that are really critical to looking after your broad health. Also the public health system. There was a ton of talk during these meetings about, we want to make sure that we understand appropriate nutrition, that we have places that we can walk, that we can have places where You know, we can look after our spiritual health and our and really look look at the whole holistic approach to health. And so it's not just about healthcare services, it's about all of the very broad level of things that keep us healthy as well. So this is what came out of our meetings, and in our report we provide a very long list of all of the other of the very specific things that came out of those meetings. So before we move this on to Anne, I just want to sort of outline the challenges and the opportunities that we felt really rose to the top. Some of the challenges that you really do have a very diverse population. Now that is a wonderful thing, but it also creates challenges, and that you need to develop a system of care that meets everyone's issues for those who across the spectrum, social, cultural, and economic diversity that exists. We also sensed that there was a competition for primary care providers, throughout the county. And in that respect, people were going outside the county where they felt that there was higher quality services potentially. And also for us to bring primary care providers into the county, you know, there was just a real competition for identify people who were going to practice here and also develop really strong primary care services here in the county so people didn't feel like they needed to leave the region. We also saw challenges around developing the resources needed for a patient-centered medical home. This is really, patient-centered medical home is a concept that is really growing nationally. And many of the providers, particularly some of the small private providers, really were not necessarily able to or had not yet embraced some of the more these patient-centered medical home concepts. Certainly there are providers out there that had, but in general we noticed that we needed to focus on trying to make sure that there was patient-centered medical home concepts embraced across the county. Again, a balance of collaboration in a competitive market. The reality is that our system of care has been based on, you know, sort of siloed providers, and we need to really work together and to collaborate across different providers and create a really welcoming integrated services where people are working together across sectors, public health, community health, and more hospital-based services. We really develop a very collaborative environment. And finally, one of the bigger challenges was that we really did find that those in low-income or uninsured population segments really had more limited access than others. So we need to develop a system that served everybody, but that really emphasized the point that we needed to ensure that those low-income had places to go. As far as the opportunities are concerned, our charge to develop a comprehensive, high-quality system is really completely aligned with what is going on with the state and the nation. And I think all of you in Maryland should be extremely proud to live in this state. Maryland is one of the real drivers of many of the health reform issues that are happening. You're leaps and bounds above so many states out there. And what we're trying to do here in the county is very much aligned with the state and with the nation. Primary care being at the center of a lot of the services, working with hospital services, and also developing population health management policy. So very much aligned with what's going on statewide and the policies that are going on nationally. One of the opportunities is that we really do need to expand access, and there are residency training sites here in the county, and really trying to think about how we can take advantage and develop some synergies around residency training sites and expanding access. FQHCs, the Federally Qualified Health Centers, which are federally subsidized healthcare clinics. There are a number of extremely well-run FQHCs here in the county, and trying to build on those clinic sites and really maximize their potential is another opportunity. Maryland's payment reform, as I said, is really developing a great sort of infrastructure for ensuring that providers are paid and through various paper performance systems and really incenting people to do the right thing. There's improved health insurance marketplace, as was mentioned. Almost more than 100,000 people signed up, and that's a real opportunity. And then just the broad stakeholder collaboration that exists, and just the spirit that we've seen here over the past year, I think is also a huge opportunity. So that is just our work in a nutshell. There, our final report, it goes into far more detail on all of these issues. But our real charge, and you know, this may be sort of the end of our work, but it is not the end of what needs to happen. And so we have Ann Keene is going to come up and talk about some of our recommendations. I encourage you all to go to our report and look at our in more detail about our findings, and then and Ann Keene is going to come talk about our recommendations. So. Thank you all and for being here, and I'll turn it over to Amy.
Are these slides online?
At the end of the presentation, I'll actually put up the website for the primary healthcare strategic plan, and those will be posted. I will say that the final written report, which is, as Alex mentioned, has more detail on the findings and the recommendations, is going through its final approval process with the county, and that will also be online, but it will be after that approval process is completed. So we can keep posted for that as well. So I'm going to go to then the recommendations that were developed from the findings. I want to say again that these are summary or highlights of our recommendations to develop the primary healthcare strategic plan. The written report will include more detail. And I'm going to go through the recommendations, and then we'll have some time for questions and answers after that. So our first recommendation, as was mentioned, we found areas in the University of Maryland in their study, found areas in the county where there were high primary health care need, and I'll explain in a moment in terms of how that was defined by the university. And so one of the first priorities and recommendations is to increase patient-centered medical practices in what we're now referring to as the health investment zones. And those are the areas we're identifying as having the highest primary health care need, and that there would also be in the recommendations to provide specific incentives to recruit primary care practices, to establish primary care practices in those health investment zones. As Alec mentioned, establishing a patient-centered medical home is very resource intensive. It requires additional staffing, electronic medical record, the ability to have health information exchange with other providers, and there is a cost associated with that. And so there may be some financial incentives that would come through the county or through private-public partnerships that would help to subsidize those practices. The federal qualified health centers also have financial benefits to serving those areas because they can get some enhanced reimbursement from Medicaid, some federal funding to subsidize for the uninsured, as well as some offset of costs for malpractice insurance. So the federally qualified health centers are a very integral part of that development of that capacity in the health investment zones. So when the University of Maryland did their public impact study, we used that study extensively in our own work and had multiple conversations with Dr. Kleinman, who is also a very important part of our advisory committee. And the University of Maryland did a very detailed analysis to identify areas of high primary care need based upon not only provider to population ratios, but also looking at the economic status of the population and also the health outcomes that were measured in terms of readmission rates and ED utilization, emergency department utilization. And that's particularly important because those are two indicators that are associated with not having strong primary health care. The high ED utilization emergency department utilization and high readmission rates. So the areas that you see here in the map, then in the red and the dark salmon color, are those that are the highest primary health care need. And that's where we focus our initial attention to expand primary care capacity. So I want to go through each one of those areas in a little bit of detail. So you pulled out the medical practice one, pulled out the zip codes that were in, again, that high primary care need areas or tending to high primary care need. And then what JSI did in terms of developing a prototype for that medical practice was to look at what were the medical services that would serve that population, looking at census data. And we also worked with an architect in designing a layout design for the space to support primary patients in a medical home. And the services here would be, we also felt would be best located in a community facility and connected in with the community and supporting some healthy initiatives, for example, having a test kitchen that could be used for diabetic patients in terms of helping them to learn how to cook healthy foods, but the community could also use that at large as well. So the supporting, again, that social ecological model, those social determinants of health, to make sure that that was incorporated into our medical practice. It would also include on-site oral health and pharmacy, because this area is also identified as an area where there's a shortage of dental services as well. So we did that for four target model practices. The second one was in the southern part of this county. This part of the county is relatively high income, so the lack of patients in a medical home had to do perhaps more with the demographics being in a more rural area, not having the concentration of services, and also a lot of small solo practitioners that really did not have the resources to have the extensive after-hours care and care coordination that is important to the patients of a medical home. So they would need additional support in that area as well. This one tended to be more focused on the adult population rather than the children and families. They certainly exist in the southern part of the county, but the adult population was considered to be the growing population in that area. The third practice was in that little segment of the county where there was a higher concentration of lower income population surrounded by higher income areas and those with a lesser need. And so that was really a pocket where we need to have some special attention in expanding, in particular, the physically qualified health center Greater Bay to serve that area to expand those services. And that was more of a smaller family practice model that could serve the entire family, adult, children through adult. And then finally, the fourth practice was also included the health enterprise zone, which the health department has worked on to expand in this very high need area in the Interbeltway. And this particular prototype is very similar to the first one in terms of oral health and on-site pharmacy. And it would also be in very close proximity to the regional medical center and really seen as serving as part of the primary care network for the regional medical center. And this one would probably be built a little bit later in terms of or expanded in terms of a little bit later in time frame so that it would be aligned with when the regional medical center would be coming online. So that was our first recommendation. And that was specific to areas that, again, identified as high primary care need, but we also found that there was just a lack of primary care practices that had been able to develop as patients in a medical home in the county. Obviously, this isn't every primary care practice. Kaiser Permanente has a very large integrated delivery system within Prince George's County, but that is a closed system with their health plan. And a lot of this had to do, again, with the characteristics of the physicians, you know, Prince George's County being smaller solo practitioners and small groups that would need additional support. So we listed, again, some ways to help build that capacity for all of the primary care practices in Prince George's County. And we also talked about the fact, so that other slide is just kind of some of the components of a patient-centered medical home, which we've already touched on in terms of being high quality, comprehensive, coordinated. And I want to talk a little bit later, I'll talk a little bit about the workforce that is important in supporting that model of care. We also, again, when we looked at the prototypes, also an understanding what we heard from the community is that they really want to go to nice places to receive care. So they don't have to be, you know, it doesn't have to be the Taj Mahal, but it needs to be really something that's aesthetically pleasing and that supports patient-centered medical homes. So that would be having the practices developed so that we can have care teams who come together and share information about the patients that they're going to serve that day, to have that coordinated, comprehensive health care. And it also allows space for oral health and on-site pharmacy, and also integration of behavioral health into primary care. And there's a lot more details in terms of the of this in our final report. We also, our third recommendation has to do with building the collaboration among the county hospitals. And there's a couple of places here we focus on. I'll look at the last bullet first, and that that all nonprofit hospitals have to do community benefit plans, strategies and plans. And those plans are not to serve just their patient population, but to improve the health of their entire community that they in which they serve, so where they sit geographically. And there was a great interest in collaborating across the hospitals and actually the establishment of a partnership where they could share information to help needs assessment and pool their resources and align their strategies in terms of supporting community benefit programs that would improve the health of the entire population. And also, this is one that's a little more tricky, is to do collaboration on
I must take time out to bring forth the man of the hour, the one who had the vision, the foresight, to know that we needed a primary health care facility here in Prince George's County. He promised us that we were going to receive one. He is the man that has delivered, the county executive, Rushern L. Baker III.
I'm not Brad Seaman, so the vision thing kind of passed on me. Dr. Dukes is here. Oh, good, good. Well, that means we really are rolling. So what did I just interrupt? Oh, good. You guys like the recommendations so far? Did you hear them? Are you excited? You got questions? What kind of questions you got? What's it going to look like? When's it going to be done? Is it going to change the area? How much is it going to cost? You know, that's what I want to know. It's a lot of questions. What about Annapolis? All Annapolis? Don't we need $15 million for the ongoing? Where's Neil? Neil, stand up for a little note. Neil, you're doing a great job. Can we give him a round of applause? All right, before somebody, Linda Wilson's not here, right? So I can't be reprimanded. Okay, good. So I can say what I want. This is great. So before I get off the stage and let you get back to real work, I want to thank you for your participation in this project. As Vanessa said, this was really, and Melanie Griffith could tell you the same thing. There are those of us who've been working on trying to get a permanent solution to the hospital situation in Prince George's County for as long as I've been involved in politics here. That goes back to 1994. One of the things I did say, and I've said this around probably more times than anybody wants to hear it, but I'll say it again. During the campaign, I made this promise that we would find a permanent solution to building a new hospital within the first year of the administration. And so once I won, I was like, oh, shoot. Mind you, I had 8 years in Annapolis and I couldn't come up with any ideas. So 1 year, how are you going to do that? So I did turn to the smartest man I ever went to school with, Brad Seaman, and I said, right after I got elected, and I was county executive elect, I said, I need your help. And he said, you know, anything I can do. I said, great. Well, there's a hospital we need to build. And I need you to start working on it right now. Well, we were fortunate that the incoming chair of the council also shared a desire to not just see a hospital built, but to see healthcare issues rise to a different level. It was not my, first of all, it was not my idea of having education, public safety, and healthcare in that order as important. I, like everybody else, thought it should be economic development, transportation, and of course, education and public safety. What I did not know and what I learned through the help of the chair at the time, Councilwoman Ingrid Turner, was the impact on those first two things that we hold dear and important in the county, education and public safety, health had the greatest impact on those two issues. And so it is thanks to her leadership and Brad Seaman that in those first 6 months, we got a deal done. So can we give her a round of applause? And Betty didn't know, Betty Francis didn't know we were gonna stick this on her. She thought she was coming in, gonna give advice and go back home. And we said, great, well, we got two great issues for you, health and education. She's like, what? But she's done a phenomenal job. If we can give her a round of applause. My only complaint about Brad Seaman is, I was like, well, if you were gonna get a deal done in 6 months, could you have not told me that during the campaign? Now I really look smart. I said, in 6 months, I'm gonna figure this out. Well, here's the good part. We did figure out what we wanted to do. We brought all the people to the table, the council, the legislative body, the governor, and our lieutenant governor, Anthony Brown, at the time, carried the weight. And Dimensions under Neil did a great job of reining in the cost at the hospital and really making it more efficient so that we could sell it to the state. And we did all of that. We came up with a deal. The question became, what would it look like and what were we building? Because the idea was not just to build a hospital. It was to build a regional medical center, but it was also to have that be part of the spoke and wheel to the healthcare throughout Prince George's County, to touch every fabric of access to quality healthcare, whether it's the schools, whether it's Greater Baden, whether it's Laurel, throughout this 500 square mile place. But the center of it is the hospital. The next step that we did thanks to your help, we get here, because the next step really was, okay, is it just about health? Well, no, it's access to health, but it's also about economic development. It's about how we would change economic development, access to quality jobs and quality health care in Prince George's County forever. That's why it was located at Largo. Having the hospital located at Largo will change the dynamics forever. Once we did that, then the question becomes, how do you pay for it? That's always the number one question. How do you pay for it? What does it look like? How does it integrate with the community? And those are the questions that you're going to have today. For our part, the council, Councilwoman Ingrid Turner, when she was chair, and as a member, and the rest of the county council, bought into the fact that we're going to have to take on some of the costs of the hospital to get us to building the new facility. So we as a county shouldered our part of the burden. We said to the state, here's what you get, if you come to the table with us. So we're almost there, is what they keep telling me. Somebody told me the other day, they were like, I thought that hospital was built already. I said, so did I. But every time nothing in my life would be simple. So we're almost there. We've got the plans that you're going to look at. But we need your input, not just in how this facility looks, but how it integrates with the community, not just around the hospital itself, but how it integrates with throughout the community, throughout Prince George's County. But we also need your help in making sure this is a new administration. They haven't spent the last 8 years dealing with the healthcare situation in Prince George's County. We were pleased that they put the $30 million for the construction in there, but they kind of left out a little line, you know, like 50, Neil, did they leave out something? Yeah, they left a little bit out, like $15 million of the ongoing cost to run the facility until we have it built. We're very confident that I met with the governor, met with the new secretary, met with the leadership, both in the House and the Senate, and we're confident that we're going to be able to restore that money. But if I could ask you, what I would ask you to do is to contact, I know council, the vice chair of the council was just here, Derek Leon Davis, but to contact your legislators and let them know how important this is. This is not a little deal. It really isn't. This right here will radically change the way downtown Largo looks. There is no downtown Largo without this. So contacting the legislative body and telling them we need this, we need you to advocate when the money is put back in the budget to keep it there. And we also need the CON to go through. So my job here today is to take up your time while everybody gets their notes ready. And to thank you for participating in this very long, and I know it's long. It started, I think we had the first one, was it a year ago? A year ago. And those of you, some of you participated even before that. You participated before we had a site. In fact, some of you participated before I was fortunate enough to be elected county executive. So you're probably more tired than I am. We want to get this built, but we want to make sure it's right. We want to make sure it's integrated in the community. But most important of all, we want to make sure it does what it's supposed to do. And that is to make sure every single person in Prince George's County has access to quality health care, and that every child that needs help and needs access can get it. But more importantly than that, that we leave a legacy for the folks who come after us, and that's our goal. Thank you very much.
As I told you, we have a champion, and so we need to get behind our county executive, contact our legislature, and let them know we want this healthcare facility built in Prince George's County real soon. So I know all of you will join us in making sure that happens. And thank you to our former council member chair, Ingrid Turner, for being here. She has been a strong advocate for healthcare, and we're so glad that you're here today. And to Neil Moore, thank you for making sure that we're changing the face of the Memphis healthcare system. Thank you so much. And we're going to get back to our program.
Thank you. I'll take a couple of moments actually to mention a few things that you just heard that I think are important to the strategic plan, and that is that we actually in our process had the opportunity to meet with Mr. Seaman on a couple of occasions and talk with him about what was happening with the Regional Medical Center. And to make sure that our strategy around primary health care was aligned with that strategy. So we realized that that was a separate but parallel process going on, and we wanted to make sure that there was alignment. And certainly the development of strong primary health care will help to be a part of that integrated delivery system with the regional medical center, certainly. And as well as the other hospitals in the county. And I do want to acknowledge that MedStar, Doctors Hospital, Fort Washington Hospital, as well as Dimensions, were all part of our advisory committee. And were very great in terms of, again, their willingness to collaborate, because healthcare is a competitive business. But they were saying that in this day and age, we don't have the luxury of being competitive so much. We really need to collaborate because there are limited resources. There are things that we can do together. There are planning that we can do together to ensure that Prince George's County residents have the full spectrum of healthcare services and all of our institutions can be financially viable. Because the hospitals and healthcare reform, they're kind of the ones that are sometimes in a difficult position, because the cost savings around healthcare reform, payment reform, often are about reducing the use of inpatient services where those services could be provided in the community. So it does provide higher quality care, but certainly requires strategy on the hospital side to think about how to repurpose some of their space and how to transition their care delivery to be part of this integrated delivery system with more community-based primary healthcare services. So I think it was really great to hear those comments and to remind myself to let you know that these two strategies are very much aligned and very dependent upon one another. So with that, I will go on with really kind of this was our recommendation around building collaboration among the hospitals, again, with the Regional Medical Center, but also the other hospitals that serve Prince George's County, and to make sure that they can all be financially viable going forward, and having the primary healthcare strategic plan support them as part of an integrated delivery system. Our fourth recommendation had to do with the development of the workforce for patient-centered care. And I'm going to skip to this slide and just talk about the points here. The fact that we're at Prince George's County Community College is very important because they are a big part of the workforce development around patient-centered care. Having a patient-centered medical home does require the development of positions in primary care that may not have existed just a few years ago. So before it might have been the physician and the nurse and maybe the receptionist at the front desk. Now we need to have community health workers, those individuals that help the low-income population to enroll in health insurance, to help to make sure that patients are getting access to other social service support services throughout the county to support their health. We have care coordinators to make sure that if a patient goes into the hospital, that when they come out, that they have a follow-up care with their primary care provider to avoid that readmission, to avoid that unnecessary emergency department visit. So those are new positions, and Prince George's Community College, under the direction of Dr. Dukes, is helping to develop training programs, new training programs, that will support the development of those new positions and help build the patient-centered medical homes throughout the county. We also have behavioral health providers integrated now into primary care, so licensed social workers, but also psychologists that help to support the behavioral health aspects of chronic care management, which we know are so important to avoid having an acute episode with a diabetic patient because they're eating well and they're taking their insulin on a timely basis. And sometimes those are behavioralists that help them to support those actions. And we also have clinical pharmacists. One of the big reasons for readmission into the hospital is because of not having good medication management at home. And so having a clinical pharmacist on site that can help with medication management is also part of a patient-centered medical home. So again, this looks very different, and it's very resource intensive, and that's why we do need to help all of the primary care providers in Prince George's County to develop these resources, including the education of this new workforce. The fifth recommendation, and I'll have a few more slides at the end, so I won't spend too much time here, but again, the marketing and branding, and this was also part of the University of Maryland study, that if we're going to build a higher quality care in Prince George's County, the Regional Medical Center and primary care, that we need to promote that from a marketing standpoint, and we also need to promote good health. So again, I'll come back to that a little bit later in the presentation. Our sixth recommendation has to really do with sustainability, and that was the development of a primary healthcare entity. We heard a lot from the stakeholders that it's great to do planning, but unless we have some mechanism to help with the implementation and the ongoing planning, that there's a possibility that this is a plan that doesn't move forward. And the county, in particular, has made a commitment that won't happen, that this will be a strategic plan that really gets implemented and is a live plan, not something sitting on the shelf. there's a lot of different models that you can have for the primary care entity. There isn't any one model you'd want to do the one that's right for Prince George's County. There are some success factors, and one of that is being governed by an independent board of directors that is stakeholder-led to ensure that this collaboration that was developed through the planning process continues through implementation. And in our plan, there are multiple roles and responsibilities that the primary healthcare entity could have, starting with facilitating the implementation, convening all the stakeholders together, administering the Prince George's Cares program, which is the program that we identified as needed for the remaining uninsured, even with the Affordable Care Act, undocumented and other individuals and families still may not have access to insurance, and so this would make sure that we cover all Prince George's County residents. And also to be that convening entity for like the Community Health Benefit Partnership to help work with the hospitals and the health department to align those initiatives. And just kind of the overall monitoring and evaluation of the plan to ensure that it is accomplishing its goals. And that's actually our last recommendation. And again, to have a defined monitoring and evaluation plan, this doesn't need to be done by any separate mechanism. There are lots of different monitoring and evaluation efforts that are going on by the County Health Department, by the state of Maryland, and you can pull those together as well as continue to track the county health rankings to see that Prince George's County does move up in those rankings, and that's our ultimate goal. But it is important to measure if we are accomplishing our goals and to take corrective action and change the strategy where that's needed going forward. I'll just say, just on the marketing strategy, I wanted to say a few words about that. There's really two major goals for the marketing strategy. One is to for the recruitment and retention of providers. You heard Alec talk about the competition for primary care providers. This is across the country. But it's a particularly acute for Prince George's County in wanting to build primary care capacity, and the fact that we are surrounded by Washington, D.C. and Montgomery County and Anne Arundel County that do offer opportunities for physicians, so we have to be very mindful in providing support to primary care physicians that want to practice and hopefully even live and practice in Prince George's County. And I'll say the regional medical center would be a part of that because it would be that anchor for recruitment and retention of physicians, all physicians, but primary care physicians as it relates to the strategy. And then the other is the recapturing the patients, reducing the out-migration. We heard one in two Prince George's County leave the county for their primary health care, not just hospital care, but primary care, and we certainly want to recapture those patients, not only just for the economic development of that, but also having community-based primary care has been shown to improve health outcomes, and so it's economic development, but also a function of quality as well. And then to have like a common branding strategy, so we just kind of came up with a brand. If we can change this, you can change it as you go forward, but Prince George's County, our health matters. So that everything that you do, all the initiatives around the primary health care strategic plan, the regional medical center, would carry, the health department would carry this message that our health matters. And that will improve, that we want to promote that we are advancing the quality of care and access to care in Prince George's County. And we are promoting the individual taking care of their own health in collaboration with the community and the organizations and systems. I'm going to just say real quickly, because I want to allow some time for questions, just to say that we can't obviously do everything at once. I think it's also important to point out that when we're talking about a strategic plan for Prince George's County, it's for the population, the people of Prince George's County. The Prince George's County government obviously has been integral in the planning process and will continue to be integral in the implementation, but it's really all of the stakeholders coming together in a public-private partnership to carry out that strategy. It will take time to do that, it will take resources, and the so one of the important ingredients to that is to establish this primary healthcare entity that would convene the stakeholders and would really then develop the more refined implementation plans to carry out the strategy. So I won't read through these, but the initial steps and ongoing are just prioritizing those things that we feel need to happen first, like recruiting positions in the health investment zones, but also those things that are needed for ongoing implementation and strategy. And then we have kind of the short term, 3 to 5 years, and then the medium to long term, with those, again, in the longer term, aligning with the expected time for the when the opening of the regional medical center. So with that, those were the recommendations, and again, very quickly, our phasing, timing, the phasing of the implementation. And the final activities is that we're just going to finalize the healthcare strategic plan, the written report. Again, once that goes through the formal approval process, that would be available on the primary healthcare strategic plan website. And then we would obviously seek approval for that plan from the county executive and the Board of Health. And once that is approved, again, those would be available then on the website. And I'll just go ahead and put up the website address for the Prince George's County Primary Healthcare Strategic Plan Project. And you can also sign up to be on a listserv to get announcements related to the strategic plan. So with that, I will close, and I guess we're gonna take questions then. So questions or comments? And I think there are microphones around the room.
There are microphones in both of the aisles and on either end. If you have a question, let's go to either end, to any mic here, as you'll see staff at the mic, and so we'll be directing, and I see that I have the first question to my left, and we'll start there. Going to have to speak directly into the mic and speak up, please.
Can you hear me now? My name is Lorraine Benson of the LGBT Enterprises. When I look at the strategic plan and everything that I've been able to uncover online, there is a lot in detail that you all have worked on. However, there is one aspect that it appears that you seem to overlook. For example, per 2013 census, there are about 480 Prince George County residents open, right? About 63,000 of those are veterans who actually served our country. The strategic plan, I didn't see anything that actually addresses how we as a county are actually going to put certain implementations and facilities in place to actually serve our veterans, like a veterans home or a court treatment facility or something in conjunction with the VA. And I don't know whether that was something that was thought about or considered, but it is an issue that is dear to my heart. One, not that I am a veteran, but my father is, and when he served, my family served. So that is my general question, is overall, has that even been considered? Because if not, I definitely have some thoughts, and some proposals, and some resources that can potentially help.
So I'll answer a couple of things. One is in terms of soldiers' homes or that would be more residential long-term care facilities. Those are not part of the primary health care strategic plan. If there needs to be planning around long-term care, in particular for the veteran population, then I think that's something to put on the agenda for future planning. But it wasn't part of the primary health care strategic plan. I will say, though, that not mentioning veterans specifically, but the patient-centered medical home, having, in particular, the integration of behavioral health, is definitely part of responding to the whole needs of the person, including veterans that that may need additional supports around behavioral health, as well as linking them to other services in the community. And that would be the care coordinators or the community health workers doing that. So I'm sorry that we didn't mention veterans specifically, but certainly their needs are mindful in the patients in the medical home concept.
Can And I just want to add just a little bit. I see that the director of our Department of Family Services is here, Teresa Grant, and she is undergoing at this time a study to determine some of the services that we need for veterans in Prince George's County. While it will not necessarily be connected with this particular plan, we do know because we have the highest number of veterans in the state of Maryland. 62,000 veterans live here in our county. And we are working very closely with the state and the federal Veterans Administration. But we also want to expand services to veterans in the county. Older veterans, but also our young military families, very important to us. So your point is well taken. And the services that we will be providing to veterans will be expanding in the county. I want to recognize also our delegate, Carolyn Howard, who has joined us.
Thank you. I appreciate that. And like I said, it is near and dear to me because there is no current facility of work in the county.
Hi, good afternoon. I wanted to ask, you mentioned that we are looking at getting highly qualified, and I want to make sure highly qualified and diverse doctors and practitioners. I even noticed in the ad that you placed there that I'm African American, but there were no white people in the ad. We need to ensure that this is a diverse population because our county is diverse. While we're 66% African American, we have a very diverse community, and this hospital has to be diverse. It really does. The other thing is, I noticed that you talked about the collaboration with, I think it was Fort Washington doctors and PG, Prince George's Hospital. Did you solicit any advice or collaborate with anyone outside of the state for best practices in some of our, some of the best hospitals in the nation?
I can take the first part of that, and I can take the second part of that. To your first question about diversity, absolutely. And it's part of all sorts of aspects of the work that we've done. Certainly when it comes to patient-centered medical home, you really have to make sure that providers are matched with those that they're serving, that they're providing culturally appropriate care. And that was just something that we've heard from the community members, and certainly something that's embedded in best practice when it comes to developing strong, acceptable primary care. So absolutely, that's part of our recommendations, and very much a part of what we heard from the community was the need for that.
So I guess I want to know what are the specifics in terms of how you will attract and get this diverse population of doctors and practitioners. Is that in the report?
Yeah, there's more detail in the report. I think the goal is having more recruitment and retention through having more residency opportunities. So the family practice residency program at Dimensions, and also taking advantage of having residents come from other training areas like Howard University and having them have resident slots not only in the hospital but also in the federally qualified health centers and other patient-centered medical homes that are developed. So what we heard from physicians that we talked to is that where they train, where they do the residency, is often a big indicator in terms of where they're going to practice. So the more residency opportunities that we have for physicians, then that will help to attract physicians to the area. And certainly looking at the diversity, when we did our prototypes for the medical practices, we looked very specifically at the census data to understand the socioeconomic diversity of the community, and you're right, it's very diverse throughout the county. I think the other place where that would come into play is the community hospital benefit program plans that have to be done. They start with the community needs assessment, which looks at the demographic profile and the health needs of the communities and how to respond to those. So those community health benefit plans that would be done in collaboration with the hospitals and the health departments would also respond to the specific cultural and ethnic and racial diversity of the communities in which they're intended to serve. So I think it's, I guess I'm saying it's blended into almost every aspect of the planning, that would be taken into consideration.
Another really quick point is that there was a dialogue throughout our assessment about trying to make sure that that those clinicians who live in the county can come back to the county to practice. So there are a lot of providers that are leaving the county to go work outside and perhaps work to effort to bring them back into the county and serve people here.
And lastly, I'll say in terms of the best practices, JSI is we're a healthcare consulting firm. That's the only business that we do. So all of the work around the best practices around community benefit, patient-centered medical home, the transition of care with the hospitals, those were all based upon best practices that, and we looked at models too in our research, but they were all based upon best practices around patient-centered care.
And I just want to add to what Ann said, that our plan is based on the School of Public Health Health Impact Study, which included best practices from multiple delivery systems across the country, more than 13 of them. So we're layering on best practices in this plan.
And the University of Maryland study also did a household survey that also looked at the desire for, they asked about the healthcare services and looked at the various responses across the demographic profile of those two. And again, that was used to inform the plan as well.
Okay, we have a question right here. Thank you. I have two questions. Concerning homeless traffic, I don't know if you have a place to address something like that. We were given health food and things out there when we first came in. But there are some people who have been over-medicated and have been helping to get
in terms of homeopathic care, I don't think that the program focused specifically on what types of primary care, but all of that is inclusive in the services that we need to offer our residents. So it is not considered a new practice anymore. Lots of primary care providers and providers in the hospitals and all, they use all kinds of methods. So we didn't specifically say that this is something we do. It is assumed that we include all practices of medicine that will benefit. We have choices now in a lot of our health plans to choose to go a natural homeopathic way as opposed to medications. But it wasn't a specific process for the primary care strategy. That's included in all, along with everything
else. And you're not alone. That was brought up in many of our community
assessments.
Along with a sort of a broad set of issues that need to be included in a comprehensive array of services. And I think it's an extremely good point. Care needs to be tailored to the people, to the residents, and we need to develop a system of care that really meets all those needs and interests.
And I would add too that when we were looking at the space planning for the prototypes, certainly thought about areas for yoga and other kinds of therapies that could be done in concert with the traditional medical care, I guess you'd call it. So those certainly were considered. But as Pam said, when we put together a whole definition of primary care for this, it really included all of those, as she said, not so much alternative anymore, but more mainstream practices to complement.
We need to probably do a better job of communicating to you how to communicate with your physicians to ask for specific treatments that are right for you. So thank you. I'll put that note down.
Treatment, you are right on.
Thank you.
Trying to really make sure that you have an engaged thoughtful communication with providers is so critical what you're talking about.
Thank you for that.
Good morning. My name is Bianca Floyd. I'm up here for a personal reason. My mother is in Lewis Hamilton. She was the founding president of the Prince George's County chapter of SCLC. For those of you who may have known my mother, she was diagnosed with pancreatic cancer in November of 2007. She passed away in March of 2008. We spent most of the last 4 months of her life running back and forth to Baltimore to John Hopkins. She was also a licensed practicing nurse. That was her first and only career. She was very interested and involved with healthcare. Great of interest to her. She was definitely an advocate. She would be absolutely delighted about the hospital coming to Largo. The location in the central area of the county would have been absolutely wonderful to her. The location across the street, near Prince George's Community Hospital, would have been wonderful to her because she also was very much an advocate for young people in education. I live across the street. I'm over here all the time. I see the young students coming in and out of the Health Services Center. I photographed this college just about every other month, and I actually photographed the construction of the health center. You guys are doing a wonderful job. I not only will write letters to you, I'm praying for your success at the hospital. I think Largo needs it, and in 6 years I have lived in this community, that is the one thing that has greatly quickened my heart. Good luck to you. Good luck, good luck, good luck to you. And thank you, Rushern Baker, and the planning board for pushing this forward. We need it.
Hi. I have a statement and a question. The statement is, I've been in Prince George's County for about 30 years, and I would say probably about 10, 15 years ago, I had an injury, and my primary care doctor told me to go to PG Hospital, go to the emergency ward. So I did go. I sat in the emergency ward for 7 hours. And I left. And consequently, when my arm was twisted, because I was never able to get medical care in a timely manner. And I'm sure there are a lot of people like me who would never go to Prince George's Community Hospital for anything unless they are in an ambulance or they are shot or bleeding. The other facilities that the missions manages are very different. And that, you know, for me, that's a stickler, that I personally would never, ever go there or tell anyone else to go there for emergency care. And also, Mr. McKinney, during your presentation, you mentioned something called pay for performance medical care. I have no idea what that is, and I'd really like to know.
Well, to your first point, that's really what this all is about. It's about trying to improve and strengthen the healthcare system, and I think we're on a great course. As far as pay for performance, it is a concept that is really growing throughout the country about trying to make sure that the healthcare systems, payment systems, are really incenting people to provide high quality care, that you're rewarding providers for their good performance. And really emphasizing, the delivery of those quality services in your payment policy, so that people who are clinicians who provide high quality care, that's patient centered, that's tailored to their patients, are rewarded for that, and it's sort of paid for that performance.
A more simpler way, also, I'd like to just add. I'm sorry, thank you. That if you look at it this way, the way the incentives and the payment incentives are going to be aligned is based on how healthy you are as a patient.
Okay, so that does not mean that if I go to my primary care doctor and I'm having a breathing problem, my doctor prescribes me something, so I feel a little bit better, and then in about a month I go back to my primary care doctor and I have a breathing problem. Now, at that point, if my primary care doctor sends me to a pulmonary specialist, will that doctor then be penalized on the amount of money that he gets for me as a patient?
No, he would not. What might be changing under the pay for performance is that we might look at, for a patient population, how are the doctors managing their patients with asthma or other breathing problems on the long term? Mm-hmm. Are they managing them so that they don't have acute episodes? And if they are doing that positively, then that would perhaps enhance their payment by the insurance company. Pay for performance, your performance is that you are helping to manage that asthma. And that's where we want to go. Not just a series of visits, but you're actually helping to help you get better or to manage a chronic condition and not have it go to acute. Does that make sense?
Some of the pay performance policies that are happening are also going to help you to not have to pay such high copays, honestly, and they help us to make sure that for those services you really need, where you might have reduced copays. And so there's really a complex set of ideas and policies that are part of this concept that are trying to reward providers providing high performing care and also reduce your access barriers, your cost barriers for services that you really need. And so it's part of a larger reform that I think are going to have a huge impact on the healthcare system.
Okay, we're going to take these two questions and then we're going to move into our second segment of our program.
How do you do? My name is Jeff Guido. I'm with Choice, Community Hub for Opportunity in Construction Employment. Choice was formed when they combined the DC and Baltimore building trade council. My questions are, how much money do we have for the hospital, and how much money do we need to build it?
So can I defer to the next presentation on that, or? Because that was not part of the primary healthcare strategic plan, but I think that will be addressed in the next presentation.
Okay, thank you.
Hello, I'm Tony Langdon. I'm on the County Commission for Individuals with Disabilities. And we would very much like someone to come to one of our meetings to discuss issues like accessibility and needs of people with disability. If we were that big, we would like to go to the meeting.
Our health officer will be more than happy to come out to your meeting. Just give us the information and we'll make sure she gets it. Thank you so much.